Welcome back to the next session of Design of Pre-Stressed Concrete Elements course. In the last session, we have been started with module number 3, that is Design of Sections for Flexure. In that module, we have started with the analysis of members at ultimate strength. So in analysis of members at ultimate strength, we have been started or introduced the topic. And later on, I've been explained what is the meaning of analysis and what we are exactly we are going to perform. And whatever the analysis we are going to perform, we are going to do the analysis with respect to the assumptions we have been considered or we need to consider. And later on, once the beam or PSA member subjected to the flexure or bending, so it will undergo the various types of flexural failure. Okay, so that aspects also has been discussed. So this is the things that we have been discussed in the last session. So let us go further with the the analysis part in this session. So as I stated, whatever the analysis we are going to perform, so this analysis will be performed for the following section, that is for a rectangular section. A rectangular section is easy to cast, but is not an efficient section because the load carrying capacity is not that much effective as compared to the flanged section. So next, another is flange section. It is the second one. It is a precast flange section with flanges either at top or bottom needs costlier former because you practically used to say that it will not be symmetrical. So practically it will be unsymmetrical. We need to cast the former properly. So sometimes we need to go with the tapering ends, all those things. So I can say the casting is difficult, but the section will be more efficient to carry the service loads. So these are the two sections I'm going to consider for the analysis in the today's session. So before proceeding to the analysis, one must thoroughly know about the Indian Standard Code provisions, in order to compute the flexural strength. So what provisions we need to consider or what provisions we need to go ahead in order to compute or calculate the flexural strength. So in this regard, so today let me discuss the Indian Standard Code provision, that is IS 1343, 2012 provisions for computing the flexural strength of rectangular sections. So let me start with rectangular section. The Indian Standard Code method for computing the flexural strength of rectangular section is based on the rectangular and parabolic stress block. So now let me go or discuss some basic things. So let me consider, so this will be the cross section of a beam. So this will be the rectangular cross section of a beam. And then this will be the width, of dimension, that is B. So small b, let me consider this as small b. And let me place a tendon. Let me place a tendon at a distance or with an effective depth D. Effective depth D. So this distance is denoted by small d. Fine. And as I stated, so because of the rectangular section and because of the symmetry, the neutral axis will lie exactly at the center. So this is regarding the figure number one. So now let me proceed with this. So this is the stress block parameter. And these things you people have been read in your Design of RC Elements course. The same thing will be holds good, here also, the same condition. Because whatever the rectangular section we have been considered in the earlier, the class or in the earlier course, the same thing have been considered in the PSE also. So please observe, so once if the rectangular section has been subjected to the bending, hope you know that the stress strain, that means the strain diagram will be like this. Okay, so it will be like this. Did you get my point? So this will be the compression zone and this will be the tension zone. Okay, so this will be the compression zone and this will be it, and this will be the neutral axis. Okay, so this will be the, okay, what I can say, the strain diagram for the particular rectangular section subjected to the flexure. Now, so in while designing this, so practically I can say that this will not be linear. Okay, practically it will not be linear variation. It will be something like, I can say, some non-linear, I can say some parabolic variations, some curvature variations will be there. Exactly, it will not be linear because here it looks something non-linear. So exactly, okay, it will be non-linear variations. Okay, so now one thing you should know that, okay, so whatever the thing, okay, I've been considered here, that means the strain, okay, or whatever the thing. So this strain, we know that we are going to consider the maximum compressive strain in the concrete. We know that 0.0035. So as IS 456 clearly specified, the maximum compressive strain, okay, in the concrete, we are going to consider will be 0.0035. Okay, so all those aspects I'm going to show in the code book also. Okay, so now, so we are going to neglect these, okay, the tensile part, that is in the design aspect, we are going to neglect this. So the diagram will be something like this. Okay, it will be something like this. So now the variations will be something like this. We are going to consider something like this. Sorry. We are going to consider the variations like this. Okay, something like this. Okay, so the variations will be like this. Okay, so this is the exactly the variation that is going to happen practically, okay, once the beam is subjected to this thing. Okay, and this is regarding the strain diagram. So, and I hope you know that the maximum compressive strain in the concrete will be 0.0035. And then also you know that the maximum, okay, what I can say, the strain, all those things, that is ES plus 0.002 divided by Fi into ES. So all those things, okay, whatever you people have been learned, the same things holds good here also. Okay, so let me come to this diagram now. So this is the stress block parameter. So this is the stress block parameter. Okay, so now please observe this. So please observe this stress block parameter carefully. So the same stress block parameter you people have been studied in the RC elements course, the same stress block parameter I've been written here also. So as you know that once the rectangular beam subjected to the flexural effect, the stress block variation will be like this. Am I right? It will be constant to some distance. And later on, the parabolic variation will be start. Okay, it will be constant to this distance. So let me know that distance. Okay, it will be constant to certain distance. Okay, and later on, after that, it will varies. Okay, like this. That is a parabolic variation. Did you get my point? So hence, what I'm trying to say here is the stress block parameter will be having a two variations. One is, I can say, rectangular. So this hatched portion, okay, will become a rectangular, okay, and this portion will become a, what I can say, parabola. Did you get my point? Okay, so now, so this is a stress block parameter or stress regarding the concrete part. So let me come to this part. So now, since, okay, the not worried much about this particular zone in the case of flexure, because in the design, as the steel is able to take care of the stresses, so why, okay, we are going to neglect this particular zone. Hence, I've been written, okay, exactly the constant line. Did you get my point? Okay, so whatever the aspects you have been learned, I'm repeating now, okay, once again. And now, This will be the neutral axis depth denoted by XU. The neutral axis depth denoted by XU. Okay, now, okay, if you want to calculate the distance of this, hope you know that, okay, you are going to draw the linear line. Okay, so let me know these variations will be 0.0035. Okay, and now the midpoint variation. Okay, because, so please consider, okay, so now let me eliminate this. Okay, so now if I'm going to consider it as a linear, okay, then whatever the variation, okay, so one sec, let me draw properly. So now let me draw this. Okay, so now this will be 0.0035, and next this will be, okay, 0.002. okay, so hope you know that. Okay, from the stress strain curve we are going to limit the maximum compressive strain in the concrete to 0.002 instead of 0.003, because in the design we are going to restrict the compressive strain in the concrete to the 0.002. did you get my point? So now you know this is XU. Okay, and this is, okay, this distance. Okay, so let me call this some distance. Okay, let me call this something like, I can say X2. Okay, X2, and let me call this as X1. Okay, so how to find out this X1, X2? So now from the similar triangle principle, okay, that is 0.0035 by XU is equal to 0.002 divided by X2. So now, okay, by calculating the value of X2, so this value will become exactly 0.57 something. So let me consider it as 0.58 XU. So this value will become 0.58 XU. Did you get my point? So I'm repeating the same thing what you people have been calculated or derived in the RC elements class. Okay, so now if this is 0.58 XU after applying the similar triangle principle, what will be this distance? So that is XU minus 0.5 XU will become 0.42 XU. So this distance will be 0.42 XU. So this distance will be 0.42 XU. Okay, so what is this distance? So this distance is the where the compressive force, that is the ultimate compressive force CU, the ultimate compressive force CU, which is acting at a distance of 0.42 XU. Please note this point. Okay, the ultimate compressive force, okay, which is acting at a distance of 0.42 XU from the extreme compression fiber. From the extreme compression fiber, the CU is acting at this particular distance. Okay, and let me know what is these things. So this is the, what I can say, the ultimate compressive force value, okay, which is given by 0.36 into FCK into beam. How you got this? This is the area of a stress block. That means by considering this, okay, by considering these two things, that is area of a rectangle and the area of a parabola, okay, you will get this ultimate compressive force. Okay, next. Next, let me go ahead with this. So this is nothing but TU, that is ultimate tensile force TU, which is equal to FPU into AP. I will tell you what is that FPU. So that is the ultimate stresses, okay, or tensile stresses, or I can say the tensile stresses in the tendon, okay, at the failure of stage of a beam. I will repeat, FPU is the tensile stress in the tendon at the failure stage of the beam. What about AP? AP is the area of pre-stressing steel. Did you get my point? And so this will be the lever arm distance. So please note down. So this is the lever arm distance. This is the lever arm distance. So let me give the, or let me know the distance of this. How to know the distance? You know that is D is effective depth. Okay. If D is deducted from this 0.4 to XU, the remaining lever arm distance will be D minus 0.4 to XU. D minus 0.4 to XU. So this will be the lever arm distance. Okay, so the distance between the compressive force and the tensile force, distance will be called as lever arm distance. Did you get my point? So this is the thing, okay, actually the stress block represents. Okay, so hope you have understood, okay, whatever I've been explained. Okay, I've been repeated the things, whatever you people have been learnt in your RC Elements course. Okay, so once I've been repeated, what are exactly the parameters that will be come across in the rectangular section? So let me go ahead further. So after knowing the stress block parameter for a rectangular section, so let me know the formula for moment of resistance for a rectangular section. Okay, or ultimate moment of resistance or flexural strength of a rectangular section is obtained from mu is equal to fpu into ap, okay, that is this thing, multiply by d minus 0.4 to xu. okay, so that will be the ultimate, that is the force, okay, multiply by the corresponding distance, which is called moment center. Okay, I'm going to consider the moment about this point. Okay, that is mu is equal to fpu into ap multiply by d minus 0.4 to xu. So this is the formula you are going to use in order to calculate the ultimate moment of resistance of the rectangular section. So let me know one by one, okay, what are all the parameters. So mu is equal to ultimate moment of resistance of the section, fpu as I stated, tensile stress in the tendon at the failure stage of the beam. Okay, tensile stress in the tendon at the failure stage of the beam. Next, fp is characteristic tensile strength of the pre-stressing steel. Fp is characteristics, and I think you will be coming to know in the next further, okay, what is fp and what is fp and how to calculate fp, all those things. Next, fpe, effective pre-stress in the tendon after losses. Okay, so please note down, there is a lot of difference between fp and fp. Fp is the characteristic tensile strength of a pre-stressing steel. FPE is the effective pre-stress left in the tendon after the losses encounter. So that is the meaning of FPE. Did you get my point? Next, AP, that is area of pre-stressing tendon or area of pre-stressing steel, and D, effective depth, XU, neutral axis depth. Okay, next, how to find out this FPU value or how to calculate the FPU value? Okay, next, to calculate the FPU value, okay, the value of FPU depends on effective reinforcement ratio. I think I've been mentioned this ratio while I'm discussing the types of flexural failure, particularly in the case of over reinforced section. Okay, so let me consider this. So if you want to calculate the FPU, first we need to know the effective reinforcement ratio. So based on effective reinforcement ratio, we are going to calculate the FPU value. So what is that effective reinforcement ratio? Effective reinforcement ratio equal to AP into FP divided by BD FCK, where FCK is the characteristic compressive strength of a concrete. Did you get my point? Next, for pre-tension and post-tension member with effective bond between concrete and tendon, the value of FPU and XU are given in table 11 of IS 13439 18. Okay, so now please note down. So if you want to calculate the FPU value and if you want to calculate the XU value, then I need to go ahead with the following steps. Okay, so that is, first calculate the effective reinforcement ratio. After calculating the effective reinforcement ratio, go to the table 11. The table 11 represent the pre-tension and post-tension members with effective bonding between the concrete and the tendon. That means the concrete and the tendons are effectively bonded. Okay, so for that, you're going to refer the table 11 of IS 1343, earlier code is 1980. So by referring this, you're going to calculate the FPU and XU value. So after calculating the FPU and XU value, you are going to substitute to the main formula. Okay, after knowing AP, FPU, D, XU, everything, and finally you are going to arrive with ultimate moment of resistance of a rectangular section. Did you get my point? Okay, so once again, I'm going to discuss this formula in the code book also. Okay, so I'm discussing with respect to the notes, and also I'm going to discuss, okay, with respect to both the codes, because okay, in the recent code, okay, they have been neglected one particular table. So I will explain that also. Okay, so why have been the neglected all those things. Okay, so the same table I'm going to refer in both the codes. Next, the effective pre-stress, that is FPE, after all the losses should not be less than 0.451 FP. So this is the condition they have been given, that is FPE, okay, which is equal to FPE, that is effective press, is equal to whatever the FPE value are going to calculate. Okay, so this FPE should not be lesser than 0.0451 FP. 0.451 FP. So this is the condition they have been given. Okay, and where FP is the characteristic, okay, strength of a pre-stressing steel. Okay, characteristic strength. How FCK will be there, like that FP will be there. FP means characteristic strength of a pre-stressing steel. Did you get my point? So this is regarding one particular, okay, way to calculate the MU. So now, instead of bonded, that means instead of good with the bonded members, if I good with unbonded members, if I come across with unbonded, and preferably this unbonded members will be observed in the case of post tension only. Am I right? Because from the basics, we know that the unbonded member or unbonded tendons will come across only in the case of post tension. Because in the pre-tension, both the concrete and the tendon will be effectively bonded. But in the case of post-tension, you know that how it has been exactly casted. So first, they are going to cast the concrete, leaving a certain space. Okay, and later on, they are going to put a tendon. Okay, so now that bonded will be, that means it is an unbonded tendon. Okay, so for this particular case, that is, for unbonded tendons in post-tension rectangular members, okay, the values of FPU and XU are influenced by the effective span to depth ratio, which are given in table 12 of IS 1343-1980. Did you get my point? So what is the difference between these two? In this particular table, we are going to refer the table 11, okay, in order to calculate FPU and XU, okay. Once if the pre-tensioned or a post-tension are effectively bonded, did you make it my point? So if the pre-tension or post-tension member, if it is effectively bonded, then I'm going to refer this table to calculate FPU and XU. If it is unbonded, so unbonded case particularly, we come across only with post-tension members. Okay, so for this particular case, you are going to calculate the FPU and XU value, okay, based upon effective span to depth ratio, which is be given in table 12. So after calculating effective span to depth ratio and then referring to the effective reinforcement ratio, you are going to calculate the FPU and XU value. I will explain these tables. Okay, but now I'm theoretically explaining. Okay, once if I'm going through the code books, I'm going to explain, okay, how exactly it looks. And also I'm going to, okay, make use of these tables in order to go ahead with the problems. Okay, so next. So I've been written one important note. What is the meaning of effective bond? What is the meaning of unbond? Okay, so effective bonded or bonded members indicates the gap between a cable and a duct is completely filled with cement slurry. Then it is called effectively bonded. If the same gap is left out, then it is called unbonded. So why they have been specifically mentioned here? Because in the problem, they are going to mention, okay, the members as bonded members, unbonded members. So we need to clearly identify which is the type of a member. So based upon the type of a member, we need to go ahead with the table to calculate this FPU and XU values. And finally with the MU value. Okay, so like this, we need to go ahead or perform the or calculate the ultimate moment of resistance for a rectangular section. Okay, hope you have understood, okay, how to go ahead. So let me go ahead with next. Okay, so next is IS code or IS standard code provision, Indian standard code provision. Okay, that is IS 13434, computing the moment of resistance or flexural strength for flanged section. Preferably, practically, we are using T or something I. So hence I've been written T sections. Okay, so the same thing holds good for even I section also. Okay, the Indian standard code provisions for computing the flexural strength of flanged section. So now let me go with the first case. So in this, let me go with this case. Okay, so let me go with first case, this one, that is case B. So when the neutral axis lies within the flange, okay, so now if this is the T section, okay, let me draw the T section. So let me draw this. This is the T section. So as you know, the T section comprises of web and a flange. So this will be the web portion. This will be the flange. Okay, now what I'm trying to say here is whatever the neutral axis which is there, that neutral axis will be lying within the flange itself. Okay, so this will be the neutral axis depth. Okay, so this neutral axis, okay, will be lying within the flange. That is XU. Okay, that is XU. Okay, measured from the extreme compression fiber, which is lying within the flange portion. Okay, so this will be called as flanged portion. Okay, so this will be called the flange portion. So the neutral axis lies within the flange, particularly for a flanged section, how to calculate the flexural strength? Okay, I will repeat. Okay, what will be the ultimate moment of resistance or flexural strength? Okay, in order to compute the flexural strength of a flanged section, if a condition applies, the neutral axis lies within the flange. So for this, let me go ahead. The Indian standard code for computing the flexural strength of a T section in which the neutral axis lies within the flange is based on the rectangular and parabolic stress block as shown in figure. That means if the neutral axis lies within the flange, we are going to compute the flexural strength. If the neutral axis lies within the flange, we are going to compute the flexural strength same as the what we did in the previous thing. That is, we are going to use the same formula. That is the ultimate moment of resistance for a rectangular section. That is FPU into AP into D minus 0.4 to XU. So this formula holds good even for flanged section when the neutral axis lies within the flange. Okay, did you get my point? So this is the very, very important thing. So that's why I've been written the neutral axis when lies within the flange, which will be the stress block parameter. Okay, as I stated, it will be the combination of rectangle and a parabola. Okay, and also I've been written one condition, so which I'm going to explain, okay, in the case of, okay, problem, while doing a problem. So we know that this will be the XU. Okay, this will be the XU. And this will be the depth of the flange. Okay, so instead of theoretically I've been written, whatever the thing I've been told, that is neutral axis lies within the flange, I've been represented with a notation. That is neutral axis XU lies within the flange means XU which is lesser than depth of the flange. So that is the meaning of XU lesser than DF. Okay, so note, okay, the same thing. It is same as the flexural strength of rectangular section. So while performing analysis, you need to check, okay, the very first step, whether the neutral axis lies within the flange or outside the flange. Okay, hope you understood. So now let me go with the another case in the flanged section. The next case says, if the same neutral axis lies outside the flange, if the same neutral axis, okay, lies outside the flange or within the web, or within the web, I can say both are same. So then what will be the conditions you will come across? So now let me draw the T section, and this will be the width of the flange. This will be the depth of the flange. Okay. And this will be the overall depth, capital D. And let me insert a cable or induce a cable. Okay, at a distance of small d or effective depth measured from the extreme compression fiber. Now let me draw the stress block parameter for this. So now we are going to draw the stress block parameter in such a way that, so let me consider this as number one. So let me consider this as the first section. Okay, let me draw the stress block parameter for this, and later on I'm going to draw the stress block parameter for this. Okay, these two things. So now let me go ahead with this. Okay, the stress block for rectangle. So as I stated, okay, if this is a rectangular section, okay, if this is a rectangular section, so then we know that, okay, from the previous case, that when you go into, okay, subject the rectangular section to the bending, then the stress block parameter will be the combination of, will be the combination of what? The rectangle plus the parabola. The same thing. Whatever I have been written in the previous case, that is in this particular case, the same condition holds good. Why? Because the section one have been considered it as rectangular section. Hence, the same condition holds good here also. So no change, FPU and this thing. Okay, and please observe. So let me call this as compression one or CU one or C one, because the compressive force, okay, ultimate compressive force acting at section one. And let me change with a small thing. Earlier it was FPU into AP, and now it is FPU into APW, because the pre-stressing steel has been induced in the web portion, hence it is the area of the pre-stressing steel in the web. Okay. Next, let me go ahead. So let me deduct this. Okay, let me go ahead with this portion. That means the section you need to consider the second portion. So for that, so this will be the, what I can say, the stress block parameter, that is FP into APF. Okay, and this will be 0.45 FCK, and C2 is given by 0.45 FCK. So this is the thing. Okay, ultimate compressive force because of these two rectangular section, 0.45 FCK. Okay, in, okay, multiply by the BF. So this will be the width of the flange minus BW. So this width will be BW. So this width will be BW. Okay, so this width will be BW. Okay, and let me go ahead with this as BF. Okay, so BF minus BW. So 0.45 FCK, okay, multiply by BF minus BW into the depth of the flange, into depth of the flange. So that will be the compressive force, okay, at or for a second section. Okay, and you already know the lever arm distance. The lever arm distance for you already know for this, the lever arm distance how to calculate. So this is D, and this particular distance will be 0.5 DF, okay, half of DF. Exactly at middle it will be acting, hence D minus 0.5 DF will be the lever arm distance for a second section. Did you get my point? So this will be the, okay, the area of stress block for the C2 portion. Okay, so like this, the stress block parameter you are going to come across, okay, particularly for a flanged section. Okay, so for this, let me write down the formula. The ultimate moment of resistance of the flanged section, no need to buy it here. Okay, so this particular formula, what is that? FPU into APW multiply by D minus 0.42x. So this formula I already know. Plus, okay, for a second section, that is 0.45 FCK into, okay, BF minus BW or B minus BW multiply by DF, into, okay, so this will be the thing, multiply by the lever arm distance. So what is that lever arm distance? That lever arm distance is D minus 0.5 DF or D minus DF by 2. Okay, it will be DF. Please note down, this is DF. Okay, that is depth of the flange. Close the bracket. Okay, so 0.45 FCK multiply by BF minus BW into DF multiply by D minus 0.5 into DF. So this formula will be used to calculate the flexural strength of a flanged section. Do you get my point? So as I stated, APW is area of pre-stressing steel for web. APF is area of pre-stressing steel for flange. Okay, and DF is thickness of the flange. And if you want to calculate AP, which is the combination of area of pre-stressing steel in the web and area of pre-stressing steel in the flange. So hence APF is equal to, okay, if you want to calculate area of pre-stressing the flange, equal to 0.45 FCK multiply by BF minus BW into DF divided by FP, which is the characteristic tensile strength of a tendon. So once if you calculate APF, okay, you already know what is AP, which will be given in the problem. So now you can calculate the APW. So that's what I've been written. After evaluating APF or after calculating APF, okay, the value of APW is obtained as APW is equal to AP minus APF. Okay. Because in the problem, they will give AP value, that is area of pre-stressing steel. So after obtaining area of pre-stressing steel and area of pre-stressing in flange, you can calculate the APW. Next, effective reinforcement ratio you're going to come across preferably in the case of flanged section. Now it is APW because, okay, the neutral axis lies outside the flange, APW into FP divided by BW. So these two things are very important. Why it is WW? Because the neutral axis lying outside the flange. So hence, the web portion will come into the picture here. That is APW and BW. Okay, so once if you know the effective reinforcement ratio, okay, go to the table 11, then corresponding to this effective reinforcement ratio, calculate FPU by point, okay, this FPU value and XU value. Okay, so like this, you are going to get in the table 11. So after getting this value, you need to cross multiply and get the FPU, both for XU and XU. Okay, FPU and XU values. Did you get my point? And here also you need to go ahead with table 11. The table 11 indicates, okay, as I stated, that is the calculation of, I can say, the FPU and XU values for post-tension and pre-tension member for effectively bonded members. Okay, so like this, we need to go ahead, or we need to calculate the flexural strength for rectangular section and the flexural strength of a flanged section. So hope you have understood. So now let me go ahead, or let me teach you all these formula in the code book. Okay, so whether these formulas are there in the code book and how to go with the table 11 and how to go with the table 12, all those things. Okay, now I'm going to teach you. So let me share these things. Okay, one second, I will share these things. So first, let me go with 2012 code. So later on, I will come to that 1980. Yeah, so this is the codal provision. Okay, so as I stated, okay, so let me, so this is the codal provision, that is IS 1343 2012 pre-stressed concrete code of practice second revision. So let me go to the page number 31. Okay, I will highlight certain things over there and later on I will come to the table. So please see the table number. Okay, the page number 31. Okay, see here in the page number 31, clearly they have been mentioned the limit state of collapse for flexure, and these are all the assumptions, okay, you need to be considered, which have been discussed in the last session, that is plain section remains plain, the bonded, the maximum strain in the concrete, okay, so all those things. And this is the, okay, these things, and the area of stress block, you can see at the 0.36 FCK into XU, multiply by the width, the depth of the center of the compressive foe, that is the this thing, okay, from the extreme fiber in the compression, that is 0.4. All these things I think I have been discussed and also have been showcased, okay, and also I think I've been told regarding the, what I can say, the maximum strain in the concrete. So all those things are given in this particular code. Okay, next let me go ahead with these things. Okay, the formula. Okay, so that's what I've been told. So this is the thing. Okay, the maximum compressive strain in the concrete is 0.0035, but we are going to limit to the 0.002, and this is the, okay, thing. So that is FCK without considering any partial safety factor, and this is the 0.67. okay, why it is 0.67 also they have been given. So it is 0.67 times the characteristic strength. For design purpose, the compressive strength of structure shall be assumed to be the 0.67. okay, later on considering the partial safety factor to above this. So that's what the limit state says. Okay, and this will be the stress block parameter. As I mentioned, it will be constant, that is 0.42 XU depth, and it will be parabola. So as I stated, the rectangle will be having a stress block variation of the combination of rectangle plus parabola. So all those aspects you can see. Okay, so now let me go to the table. So that is very important. So now, annexure D first, let me go at annexure D. So annexure D will be there in page number 51. Yeah, page number. So all this very, very important. Okay, you need to remember this page number, everything, because in the exam, you can save the time. So in the page number 51, okay, you can see page number 51. Moment of resistance for a rectangular section. So as I stated, you can calculate the moment of resistance with respect to this formula. You can see here, mu is equal to FPU. Okay, instead of FPU, they have been mentioned FPB. Okay, multiply by APU, that is APS, into D minus 0.4, because in the revised code, they have been changed. But in the earlier code, the same formula is there. So that also I'm going to discuss. Okay, and whatever the condition have been highlighted, okay, the same thing, that is effective pre-stressing should not be lesser than this 0.45 FPU, all those condition, okay, highlighted in this particular, okay, page number. So that is in the annexure D. So this formula you are going to use in order to calculate the moment of resistance for a rectangular section. But no formula, okay, then beyond being the code for flanged section. So please note down. Okay, the for flanged section, you need to remember the formula in the examination. So while performing. So instead of remembering, okay, how you're going to remember the formula, I've been explained in the stress block parameters. So this is the table 11. So that is the condition for ultimate limit state for rectangular beam with pre-tension tendon or with post-tension tendon having effectively bonded. So as I stated, first you should know the effective reinforcement ratio, that is AP into FP divided by BDF CK. After knowing effective reinforcement ratio, you can go with FP divided by 0.87 FP. Okay. And this will be the XU by D. Okay, so you can calculate these values, that is stress in tendon as proportion of the design strength. Okay, so by going with these things, okay, by referring the table 11, you can pick the value. Did you get my point? And also one must observe a very important thing. So these values will vary, that is FPU by 0.87 FP and XU by D values will vary based upon the member, that is whether it is pre-tension member or post-tension member. So based upon that, you need to pick up these values and calculate the FPU and XU value. Did you get my point? So hope, okay, you have understood how to go ahead. But please observe, in this particular 2012 code, they have been neglected the unbonded. So no table 12 you can observe in the IS 1343 2012. That means in the revised code, what is clearly specifying that, so while analyzing the flexural strength for a flanged section or for a rectangular section, you are going to consider the effectively bonded pre-tension and post-tension, because this effectively bonded will be coming only in the case of post-tension. Because anyway, pre-tension members, you already know that the pre-tension members will be created by effectively bonding the concrete and the steel. But in the case of post-tension member, so you need to go ahead with effective bonded tendons only. Nowhere you need to go ahead with unbonded. So that is the revision. Okay, they have been come across from 80, that is 1980 code to the 2012. Did you get my point? So in the 2012, you know where you're going to come across the unbonded post tension member with unbonded, that is table number 12. So please note all these things. These are very, very important. So now if you want to come across table 12, how to go ahead with that? So for that also, let me share that. So let me share that particular code. So let me go ahead with that particular code. One sec. So let me go with the 1980 code. Okay. So this is the table number 12. Okay. So as I stated, see here the notations, how it has been changed. Okay. The same notation I've been used, M is equal to FPU into AP into D minus 0.42 XU. But in the 2012, they have been changed these conventions. Okay. And the same condition, no change in the condition. Okay. Here, there it was annexure D, page number 51. Here, page number 59, annexure B. Okay. This is the change. And the next thing, okay, please observe. The table 11 represents the condition at the ultimate limit state for rectangular beams with pre-tension tendon or with post-tension tendon having effectively bonded. So the same thing which have been discussed. So after going with effective reinforcement ratio, so then you go to this table to calculate FPU value and XU value. Okay, the same thing. Okay, after calculate, okay, this conditions will hold good based upon the pre-tension and the post-tension members. Is it clear? So after coming to know about whether it is pre-tension or post-tension members, you can pick up the value of FPU by 0.87 FP based on effective reinforcement ratio and also XU by D value based on effective reinforcement ratio. So after obtaining this ratio, you can calculate the FPU value by cross multiplying this denominator. Okay, and also XU by D also, you will get, after getting the value from the table 11, cross multiply by the effective depth, then you will get the XU value. So after getting FPU and XU, substitute in the above formula, you will get the ultimate moment of resistance of the section. So like this, you need to go ahead with the table 11. So the table 12, which was missing in the 2012 code, you can see in the present, okay, that 1980 code. So this table 12 says the condition at the ultimate limit state for post tension rectangular beams having unbounded tendon. So how to go ahead with this? So preferably the table 12 will be holds good for post tension member, okay, with unbounded tendons, unbounded members only. So once again, calculate the effective reinforcement ratio. Now, apart from effective reinforcement ratio, if you want to calculate FPU and this XU value, one more value you should know, as I stated, that is effective span to effective depth ratio. Okay, after knowing effective reinforcement ratio and effective span by effective depth ratio, you can pick up the values of FPU by FP value and XU by D value for post tension member which is unbounded. I will repeat, the table 12, you are going to choose the FPU and XU value based on effective reinforcement ratio, and one more thing, effective span by effective depth ratio. So based on these two data, you are going to pick up the FPU by FP and XU by D value. So after obtaining this FPU by FP and XU by D, as I stated, cross multiply the things and you will get the value of FPU and XU. Did you get my point? So hope you have understood how to go ahead with. So this is regarding the IS-1343. So what I've been explained this. Okay, basically in practical case, we have been neglected this condition. So in 2012, they have been revised by and say that whatever the post tension members you are using in the any section or anything, okay, then preferably we need to go with the bonded members only, because the assumptions clearly says that the concrete and steel should be well bonded. Okay, but in the earlier code, they were also going with unbounded tendons. So hence, we're going to see the table 12 in the 1980 code also. Okay, and one more thing, because in the examination, they may ask the unbounded tendons also. Okay, that's why maybe a chance they will give the unbounded. So that's why I've been explained this table 12 also. And rest of the things remain same, as I discussed in 2012. Okay, so hope you have understood. Okay, so this is regarding the, what I can say, the calculation of flexural strength for rectangular section and for a flanged section. Okay, so in this particular session, I have been taught how to calculate the flexural strength or ultimate moment of resistance for rectangular section and flanged section. Okay, so hope you understood. Okay, so with this, I'm going to continue the problems in the next session. Thank you for joining.